Hey guys, welcome to another unboxing. You guys send us so many requests in the comments to talk about this gem and that gem. So today we're gonna talk about a few of your viewer requests.
They called me in once again. Oh, this box is kind of heavier than it looks. Christina Duarte wants us to feature this gem that proves volcanoes can create rainbows. I'm like halfway there. Let's open this bad boy up. Oh, I got a flashlight. Oh, okay. All right. I am correct. We got what I would bet money on is obsidian. The first thing that I notice is the wavy undulating surface of this specimen. It looks just like a piece of broken glass. And that is because obsidian is a naturally forming glass. It forms when lava cools very, very rapidly and doesn't have time to actually create a regular crystalline structure, and it instead creates an amorphous structure. Some other natural glasses are moldavite and other tektites and impactites. This, however, does not have nearly as violent a creation story as moldavite does. So it comes from lava with high silica content. So it's about 70% silicon dioxide. So early prehistoric humans would use obsidian for creating scraping tools and blades, because obsidian can get wickedly sharp, much sharper than a steel blade can. Obsidian was also used as an early type of mirror. Of course, it's gonna be a little bit darker of a reflection. So the particular variety of obsidian we have here today is rainbow obsidian. And it's called that because if you can get the light to hit it just right, you'll actually see a little dance of different colors on the surface of it. So there is a little patch of arcing like rainbow colors here. That's probably due to the fracture. Well, all of it is due to light interference. But so rainbow obsidian kind of gets its rainbow name from the effect that we see. And the effect that we see is caused by a number of things. It can be nanorod inclusions of Hedenbergite in Mexican rainbow obsidian. It can be in California rainbow obsidian. It's thought to be caused by magnetite inclusions. In other parts of the world, it's thought to be caused by just simple air bubbles. But what happens is light is refracted as it goes through these layers of material, and some light is bounced back and other light gets through to a second layer and a third layer, and some light is reflected by that third layer, some light is reflected by the second layer, and all these rays of light interfere with each other and we get a rainbow color. We get a little optical effect. So these other two more unassuming rocks that we have here are also obsidian. They're a variety of rainbow obsidian called velvet rainbow obsidian. So in order to get our phenomena to raise its head here in the velvet rainbow obsidian, we've got to get it wet. So I've got a bowl of water here. We're gonna dunk some rocks. Okay, let's see what we can do here. So I can actually see that there are definitely like layers, there are striations along this thing. So I'm gonna kind of go along. Oh, there he is. I'm getting more colors than in the big specimen. This is really neat. It's not flashing or anything, but I am getting, oh, there we go. Oh, over, up in here as well. Really awesome. Yeah, I've got blues, purples, some sort of bluish green. I'm gonna try the other one, because this one does not have as obvious lines in it as that other one does. So I don't know where to look. It's very subtle on this piece. There it goes. Yeah, so, okay, so with this obsidian, you kind of have to shine it sort of parallel to the surface to get that, to get the color to come out. But with this one, I pretty much have to be directly, almost perpendicular to the surface. You know what, it reminds me of seeing Opal in Matrix a little bit, but just a lot more subdued. All right, guys, I want to take a closer look at one of these specimens today. Let's take a look at this big boy. You guys tell me what you can see. Let's take a closer look.
Jessica Damore asked for this rare mineral known as a pronunciation nightmare. There are a few minerals that are, you know, kind of tricky to say. So there are things like, you know, pizotaite, which is a rare gemstone, kind of similar to beryl, gertite. It doesn't look like how it's spelled. So, you know, there are a lot of different nuances in the gem and mineral world. So let's open the box. Ooh, well, this is, see if I can pronounce it, Jeremejevite, named after Pavel Jeremejev, a Russian who founded this. It was found in 1883 in Russia as small single crystals in some granitic debris, meaning it wasn't just a big hunk of crystal popping out of the ground or the side of a mountain. So Jeremejevite actually is super rare in large sizes. It's often found in less than 2 carats. Here you can see it in its crystalline form. So this is Jeremejevite actually on some other material. Okay, so Jeremejevite is a borate mineral. It's part of the hexagonal crystal system. It can be a few different colors. It can be yellows, it can be colorless, but generally it's this light blue kind of color. Like we said, this is considered one of the more difficult minerals to pronounce. I pronounce it Jeremejevite. It looks like Jeremejevite. So bear with me if my pronunciation is a little bit off with the rest of the mineralogical world who thinks it's also difficult to pronounce, but that's what makes some of these things so fun. So an interesting thing about Jeremejevite is they're typically found in very, very small carat weights, but the crystals, when found, are often euhedral or well-formed. So the crystal faces, the crystal structure, is typically pretty well-defined. Jeremejevite has similar properties. It has a similar hardness to things like aquamarine, to things like topaz. It actually even has a higher refractive index. So there are a lot of things about Jeremejevite that actually make it a really good gemstone, particularly for everyday wear, for placing in jewelry. However, the quantities are small and the sizes are so small that it's not feasible to even create this in jewelry, and you're not generally going to find pieces that are even suitable for jewelry. One interesting thing that caught my eye about this is it looks like that there was actually a larger piece of Jeremejevite within this specimen. So you can see at the base, you can see the crystal, and then there's a little bit of a gap, and you can see on both sides kind of like some shards or something going into the gap. And then you have a piece of crystal here, and then you have another gap right here. So I don't know what happened to this guy, but I do think that there's a chance that there was a larger specimen embedded within this matrix. It's often found in association with things like albite, feldspars, tourmaline, and quartz. And similarly to quartz and tourmaline, Jeremejevites are actually piezoelectric, which means that when subjected to pressure, they can produce electricity. So a lot of sources say that Jeremejevite is one of the most rare gemstones. It's gonna cost about $2,000 a carat, making it one of the more expensive gemstones per carat. Okay, so we've got two pretty different specimens here. I really like this one because of just the different like bluish green color of the matrix and then the blue color of the Jeremejevite crystal. I love how it's encapsulated in there, but I'm actually gonna have you take a closer look at this one. Just the crystal form is so well formed that it's beautiful to see how you can have such a perfect crystal in such a small size. So I want you to take a look and enjoy.
We have a
what's actually
card here. Brisamar Gutierrez Para asked us to feature the stone whose beautiful color is quite complicated. All right, do you want to do the honors and open it?
Okay, let's open the lid here and see what we've got. Oh.
Oh wow.
You're right about color.
A very distinct gem. You can tell due to the crystal structure and the coloration, it's amazonite.
Mm-hmm. Piece in particular is just the most exquisite color.
I don't think there's really any stone that you can really, like you see amazonite, you can almost side ID it because it's so distinctive in crystal structure and color. Amazonite is a microcline feldspar and it typically has these white intergrowths that are kind of wavy, and that is intergrowths of another feldspar called albite. Which, so amazonite is
a potassium feldspar, whereas albite is a sodium feldspar.
I think one of my favorite things about Amazonite is that it's been used for gemstones and adornment for over 2,000 years. It's been found on archaeological sites and used by civilizations such as ancient Egypt and Mesopotamia.
Known to be used by the South American civilizations such as the Mayan and the Aztecs, but because there's not a lot of intact history there, you can't really tell like how long they had been using it or what deposits they used to get the Amazonite. But it's called Amazonite, but there are no known deposits of Amazonite in the Amazon rainforest. So it's a little bit peculiar that it actually has that name. So we had a viewer ask us about the differences between Amazonite and aventurine. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, sure. So if you're talking about the green variety of aventurine quartz, apart from sort of doing a deep dive structurally and chemically, and the fact that they're two different species, you've also got the fact of observational features. So with your aventurine quartz, if you look at it using a loupe or under magnification, you're going to see green platy inclusions of mica, which give rise to its overall body color. You just don't really get that in your Amazonite. It's more of a opaque material. And as you mentioned earlier, with the little inclusions of albite, the white mottling of the albite in there as well, which you wouldn't get in your adventuring quartz. So looking at these beautiful colors that we have in front of us, I adore this one.
I really like that. I wish I had that one. Yeah, same.
Can you give us an idea? What causes that color? Do we know? Is it understood? How do we get that?
So the actual cause of color has to do with lead. It's not distinctly caused by the lead content of the Amazonite, but it's caused by something called an electron hole. So the lead in the Amazonite is positively charged, and it causes a vacancy to exist within the crystal structure in the form of something called an electron hole. No matter what way the crystal lattice is kind of shifted, there's always a vacancy that exists within the crystal structure.
So those holes or vacancies, I'm assuming they might give rise to different absorptions, and that's why we would see that particular color.
Yeah, that's the general idea. It's still a little misunderstood, and as to what exactly causes these vacancies is not really clear. There are several ideas as to why these vacancies might occur. One is radiation from being in the ground, and lead obviously is related to uranium, so that might be a correlation there.
So something a little similar to the way in which green diamonds get their coloration. They have these holes knocked in their crystal structure by radiation.
And then another idea for what might cause the electron holes is heating, just simply heat within the ground. And another is potentially what is called isomorphism, which is where you have same crystal structure, but you have two different elements competing for the same spot within the crystal structure.
It's very rare that you get Amazonite that has any translucency or gem quality to it. But I have here a little gemmy piece of Amazonite there, which is something that you don't often see. This is said to originate in Vietnam. That was the provenance from the dealer from which it was purchased. But you don't really see it in this the gem quality. A similar coloration to the pieces that we have here. This wonderful kind of bluey sea green, which is gorgeous. We're gonna take a specimen for a closer look. Should we pick which one we want to?
Yes.
Gonna go for one, two, three.
Yeah. That one.
For me, it's twofold. And Caleb, you might have the same sort of opinion here. It's the color of this is just exquisite. I'm not a blue person at all or a blue-green person at all, but this is just delicious. The quality of the crystal structure that you've got going on here, that the habit of the crystal, it's just fantastic.
It seems like a very pure sample. Like if you look at some of these, like in comparison, you can tell there's a lot more impurities in these other samples. Even from its crystal structure, you can tell that like this is a pristine example of Amazonite in both crystal structure and color. Kind of like when I think of Amazonite, I think of something like this.
Okay, so to Jessica, to Christina, to Brismar, thank you so much for sending in these requests. We love to hear them. Everyone else, Let us know down in the comments if there are any other gems that you'd like to hear us talk about. And in the meantime, head over to gemstones.com, our new website. You can learn all about your favorite gemstones and even ones that you've never heard about. We hope you learned something fun today. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and ring that bell so you don't miss out on our future videos. Thanks for watching. Mm-hmm.